Hinds that how much I read into what he writes and listen and try to decipher deep into what he says, because there are some people, and I'm just laying the groundwork here for this discussion, there are some people might be an idol for someone, and so it's not easy being an idol. You know why? Because you've got to know how you're standing, how your posture, how you're talking, how you're acting, your body language, everything. What you say unofficially in the company of friends. For example, I was a cricket commentator, and I know that every time I step out of this country, I can't be urinating on the roadside, I can't be drunk, I have to be a good ambassador of my flag, not of a government, but of my flag. Mm-hmm. And so I know I've been putting you under some pressure too by telling you that I'm an admirer of David Hinds. This 32 years ago, Doc, that was quite a memorable day for you.
Yes, yes. Personally, politically, in every sense, because Walter Rodney represented the best.
Of the best.
Of the best in us as Guyanese, as Caribbean people, as oppressed people. He was a wonderful human being.
But why? Could you identify some instinct of his in his persona? What was so wonderful about Rodney?
It's that he brought together everything about what we in Guyana and the Caribbean were about. C.L.R. James, who was an idol of Rodney, idolized Rodney, loved Rodney, was his student. And he loved him and wept when Rodney was murdered. Here was C.L.R. James, this world figure who was almost 80 years at the time, weeping when his young comrade died. And C.L.R. James said that in history, there are some people who have the capacity to embody the aspirations, to embody the struggles of a people, and then take all of that energy and move with it. He says that about Gary Sobers, for example. He says that about Rohan Kanai. He says that about the Mighty Sparrow and Bob Marley. And he said that about Walter Rodney. People who embody everything.
They're just a cut above.
Yes, a cut above. And not just the embodiment, but they have the capacity to take all the energies of the people and move to another level. So they actually move the society by their mere presence. And Rodney was one such person.
But you sat with him, hugged, talked with him. Well, tell me about this guy. Outside of a political forum, I mean, what does he joke a lot? Is he what? He's nervous. He's angry. What kind of guy is
regular? That? Regular guy, quiet, unassuming. Chats, talks about cricket. He loved to dance. It wasn't just politics all the time. Talks about life and so forth. My first sight of Dr. Rodney was in 1974 when he first came back to Guyana. And I, as you know, I'm from Buxton, and Brother UC had invited him there to meet some of us young people. We were 13, 14
years old. But he came back. He came back from what, Jamaica?
He came back from Africa. Africa. Right. He had been in Tanzania from 1969 to 1974 after he was kicked out of Jamaica in 1968. And we were sitting in that room, County High School, Brother UC school in Buxton, and we're waiting for Dr. Walter Rodney. As youngsters, we had heard of this great Guyanese.
But he was what, in his 20s then?
Yes, he was in his early 30s. He was 32 actually.
And so how big, bigger than you, he was?
About 17 years. Okay. All right, so, but he was a young man.
No, you were 17 then?
I was 15 then. 15. Right, uh-huh. Okay. I was 15 then, right? And we are excitedly waiting for Dr. Rodney. And this person walked into the room, jeans.
Afro.
Yes, glasses. Afro, and we said, well, no, that's not Dr. Rodney.
He looks too ordinary.
Yeah, too ordinary. Uh-huh. And he came in and he sat down and we sat down and we were waiting. Then Brother UC said,
here's the guy.
Here is Walter Rodney. Hmm. And we were shocked. So that's my first impression. An ordinary person. who does not make himself an idiot, as my comrade and I would say. Because he came from working class background. His parents, his father was a tailor. His mother, a homemaker. They lived in Bend Street.
Which village?
In Georgetown. In Bend Street, Georgetown. Right. So
right there he died, actually.
Exactly. Not far from where he died. Mm-hmm. So and this is a person who then, in a short time, rose to world prominence. And here he was.
In academia.
As a political intellectual, as a political analyst, as a political activist. Because this was not your academic who sat down in a room and just read books, right? His classroom was out there among the masses. Hence the term that is associated with him, grounding with my brothers and sisters. And when he spoke to us that day, I remembered one thing, said a lot of things, some of which at 15-year-olds we probably didn't have a sense of. But I remember him saying that history is written not just by leaders, but most importantly, by ordinary people, and that someday someone will tell the world that we were sitting in this room and talking about the future of Guyana. And that blew me away. Mm-hmm. I went home and I told my aunt, I just listened to this man, and I like what he said, I want to join this thing. Mm-hmm. And that's how I became a political activist.
But he was pretty rebellious, right? I mean, anything that seems wrong, morally wrong to him. Jamaica kicked him out. Why?
Because he went to Jamaica as a young professor, just finished his PhD at age 24.
UWI? Was it UWI?
The School of Oriental Studies in England. That's where he did his PhD. And but he had studied at UWI as an undergraduate from 1960 to 1963. So he had left in 63, got his PhD in 66, came back after a short stint in Tanzania, a semester or so, came back to Jamaica to teach at the UWI. And he came back and wanted to teach African history. But UWI, this is 1966, is not about to have African history taught at the University of the West Indies.
Which is bad.
Which was bad.
Why shouldn't you know your history?
Exactly. You know? But remember, we are just coming out of colonialism in the early days of independence. And independence is becoming not the freedom that we envisage. Independence is becoming this accommodation with the past colonizers. And so we continue to run our institutions in the way that they were run during the period of colonialism. So we were giving our young people at the time a colonial education still, even though we're 4 years into independence. Jamaica and Trinidad had gotten their independence. And so Rodney went out into the streets where ordinary people, whoever would listen, among the Rastafarians, and began to talk to them about African history.
Yes.
And that scared the daylights out of the rulers of Jamaica.
But there were local rulers. Who was the prime minister?
The prime minister was a man named Hugh Shearer.
West Indian?
A West Indian Jamaican. And he was leader of the then Jamaica Labour Party government. And Hugh Shearer, a black man, is banning a black man from a country that is 95% black for teaching black history.
And that is independent.
And it is that propelled Rodney. Now, when Rodney got banned from Jamaica in October 1968, the word got around in Jamaica that he was banned. So the students who were losing a popular professor decided,
a brother,
that they were going to march the next day to the prime minister's office. And so they put on their caps and gongs and began to march to the prime minister's office. As they are going towards the office, they saw a crowd coming from the opposite direction. Lo and behold, that crowd was ordinary people, Rastafarians, who Rodney would speak to in the afternoons, on the weekends. And these two forces, the working people of Jamaica and the students and academics, marched together, marched to the office. The police intervened. We had what is now referred to as the Rodney riots. The people decided to fight back against the police, and there was a riot. Two or three people died. Property was damaged. Some of the people in that march were Prime Minister Ralph Gonzales, who was the leader of the student movement in Jamaica at that time and led the march. Former Prime Minister Patrick Manning was also in that march.
But he was a student.
A student, they were all students. So a whole generation of Caribbean people would become prominent in Caribbean politics later on, were in that march around.
So it was after Jamaica, then Africa?
After Jamaica, he spent a little while in Cuba. He went to Cuba, cooled his head there for a little while, and then he went to Africa, to Tanzania.
I'm a little surprised he didn't go after Castro as well.
Well, you know, he had an interesting take on Castro. Uh-huh. When Castro sent troops to Angola to help the African freedom fighters push back the South African army that was moving into the frontline states, Rodney said that Fidel Castro was the blackest man in the world. When Fidel Castro and the Cubans sent troops to intervene in the internal conflict in Ethiopia, he said Castro was wrong. That's Rodney. Mm-hmm. He was a concretist. All right. He told it like it is. If you do something revolutionary, Rodney says, that is revolutionary. If you move in another direction, he says that he was not a dogmatist. He was not someone who would say you are doing the right thing when in his mind you're working against the interests of ordinary people. His form of assessment as always, how are you working in the interests of the ordinary, people, the downtrodden in society? That's how he evaluated a political and intellectual.
But somebody told me that Rodney hadn't a good pair of shoes sometime when he came to Guyana. He was poverty-stricken like? I mean, or money didn't bother him.
Right.
Because
no.
as a lecturer, right, you must be earning.
Right. But unlike other professors who had begun to earn some money, he wasn't going to spend it on the most fancy boots and all that kind of stuff. He spent it on his family. He was very committed to his family. That was very important. And he was less concerned about the material things in life. We have a tradition of that here. I want to put a Dr. Chedi Jagan and a UC Quayana in that bracket here, yes. Political leaders who identified with the working people, not just in terms of word, but by the way they live. Mm-hmm. And Walter Rodney fell into that tradition.
Okay, we're talking with Dr. David Hinds, and we're remembering that fatal day when Dr. Rodney was slain. We're coming to that point. But let's just go for a commercial break. When we come back, what happened in Africa, and then what happened in Guyana?
BPATS brings to you longer-lasting Energizer LED torchlights. They're handy lights like the pen lights, keychain lights, compact lights, and headlights. For the home, they're flashlights and nightlights. For outdoor work use, there's single and dual LED lights and the professional hard case weather resistant lights. And to keep all of your battery operated electronics going, stock up on longer lasting Energizer batteries. Energizer products distributed by BPATS and available at all leading supermarkets and stores nationwide.
Sweet pea, you started on big TV star. I'm going to make sure I'll be cooking nice food. Is Benny coming again?
He coming Sunday 1 o'clock. I'm making his favorite chicken curry, dal, rice.
Girl, today not Sunday. Little boy, go catch the fire side. Bowji, bust the chicken neck. And you, sweet pea neck, so you prepare my favorite rice.
Oh, my niece, I see you prepared a lovely meal for me. Chicken curry, dal,
and chacha, Alisi rice, your favorite.
I only use Alisi's rice since its glycemic index is below other rice.
Which means it is healthy and not as fattening as other rice.
So I can look like this and not like that.
Alisi's world famous rice.
Now you're cooking.
What you want?
electricity in your area? Wish to reduce your electricity bill? Then think solar. We're proud to bring you cost-effective ways for renewable and alternative energy. At Gafur's Solar Energy Department, we offer a wide range of products that are environmentally friendly and built to last a lifetime. We now have in stock complete solar water heater systems in sizes 40 and 60 gallons. Prices start from $206,050. Solar refrigerators and freezers in 8.1 cubic feet sizes. Solar lighting systems comes complete with two LED lights, charge controller and battery for only $24,840. Screw type rechargeable LED lights that'll automatically come on if there's a power failure. Automatic inverters and deep cycle batteries. Our services include advising you about a system to match your budget. There are also installation services available. Service, quality, and price. It's Gafur's, the name you can trust.
It's Big Johnny. He's out of defenses on Mikey White. He's holding on to that bull, but he's got to hold on for longer than a full minute. Can he do it? No, he's off. He's finished.
He only stayed 15 seconds on the bull. Your dollar will last longer with GT&T. GT&T, it's just a dollar.
NT Computec is the place to shop. If you're looking for a personal computer or small, medium, or large business solutions, get desktops, laptops, servers, storage, and UPS. NT Computec carries the latest range of processors, motherboards, video cards, and hard drives. NT Computec provides services such as computer repairs, networking, CCTV surveillance, and APC infrastructure installation. NT Computec is an authorized reseller for Dell and APC products. We offer the best technical support and customer service in the business. NT Computec, your technology partner.
Okay, welcome back to the program. We're talking with Dr. David Hinds and talking about the great legendary Walter Rodney. Dr. Hinds, you mentioned Rodney wanted to teach African history in Jamaica. I want to understand this guy a little more. Was he more interested in fighting for the well-being and development of his African brothers and sister, or did you sense that he was more involved as a human being with every single human being that is suffering, for example?
Yes. Here was an African, proud of his ancestry, proud of his people, but who saw the experiences of African people within the larger context of the experiences of working people of all races. Saw that African history for him was an entree, a medium through which he spoke not just to African people, but to people all over the world. Mm-hmm. While in Jamaica in 1968, in his definition of Black power, Black power, which was defined in the United States as the empowerment of people of African descent, Rodney says in the Caribbean that Black power must include East Indians. He didn't see how you could talk about empowerment, about Black power in the Caribbean with only African people, that you must include East Indians. What he did was to redefine the meaning of Black power, to help it make sense to the Caribbean. He developed, instead of a racial definition of Black power,
that's what I was getting at.
He developed a political definition of Black power.
A larger spectrum.
Larger spectrum, and that's Rodney. So Africa was central. African people were central, but he was not confined by his Africanness. Here was an African, very proud, but not confined by it. Always trying to understand how African people and other oppressed people, East Indian and Amerindians and all the other oppressed peoples of the world can come together and advance humanity. That's the hallmark of Walter Rodney.
So he left Jamaica, well, was chased out of Jamaica,
yes,
and then went to?
Went to Cuba for a little while, yeah, and then eventually to Tanzania.
And what was he doing there?
He was teaching at the University of Tanzania, which at that time was a center of academic and political activity. Lots of African Americans and some West Indians had gone to Ghana after Kwame Nkrumah had brought Ghana to independence in 1957, and lots of African Americans and Caribbeans had gone there to work to help to develop Africa. Kwame Nkrumah was overthrown in 1964, and a lot of those scholars and activists then went to Tanzania under Julius Nyerere. Tanzania had announced what it called the Ujamaa revolution, and Rodney went there at that time. So here he is getting a chance to teach African history, not just to Africans, because at the university there were people from all over Africa, but also students from the United States and the Caribbean who were there.
But would I be right to say that if you're an African ruler, don't feel too comfortable that Rodney is supposed to like you, because he can make problems for you if you're not a good African ruler. Am I right?
You're right, because part of what he did while at the university there in Tanzania was to begin to critique the post-colonial leadership in Africa, and begun to ask questions about the direction of the independence that they had gotten from the colonial powers. What is the content of that independence? Where are you taking this independence? Is this independence about the toilers? Is it about the sufferers? And if it's not about them, then you have lost your way. So his critique is post-colonial critique of black governments in Africa, in the Caribbean, brown governments, began while he was there, asking questions about where you're taking this independence. And it's out of that discourse, among the people, again, he would go out into the countryside in Tanzania, he would go on the front line with the freedom fighters who were fighting against the South African regime, against the Rhodesia apartheid regime. Rodney is among the soldiers, helping to educate them, so that you're not just a soldier with a gun in your hand, but you're armed with the tool of history and social analysis of your society.
He was not banned from Tanzania.
No, he was not banned from Tanzania. While he was there, he gave a series of lectures to the teachers in Tanzania. And out of those lectures came a book called How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, which is still the most important book on African and Third World historiography.
But did he get into the conflict with the political elites in Tanzania?
No, there was not any open conflict. They were uncomfortable, I would imagine, at some of the things that he said, because he would write in the newspapers. And he had a lot of polemics with some of the leading African scholars. Missouri, who a prominent African scholar, was there at the time, and Rodney and Missouri had some toe-to-toe discourses on independence and so forth. So he was engaged in the discourse, but he was always conscious. Rodney was always conscious that although he is black, although he's from African descent, that when he was in Africa, he doesn't belong there. There's a question of language, there's a question of nationalism, he had not become a Tanzanian citizen. And so for him, the place where you're going to make the biggest contribution, the place where you're going to effect fundamental change, is going to be where you are. If you can do it right where you live, that will be your most important contribution to world history. And so he comes back to Guyana.
But deliberately? I mean, he wanted to effect a change?
Yes.
Or he just... Okay, I'm going home to take a little rest.
No.
He left that mission.
For Rodney, scholarship was always up towards a political end. I am reading these books. I am acquiring this knowledge. I'm traveling the world. I'm learning the world. To do what? To liberate the people. Why do I want to liberate them? Because it is out of their sweat and toil that I was able to go to university and acquire this knowledge. So I must put my knowledge at the surface of the people, most importantly, the working people. That was always Rodney, wherever he was. And Guyana is his homeland. He had been away from here for 14 years. He felt it was time to come back and to begin to make a contribution.
So that move was calculated?
It was a deliberate move.
Deliberate.
Of course, there were persons here who were urging. Clive Thomas, Dr. Clive Thomas, I know you interviewed him. Dr. Clive Thomas, another legend, had spent some time in Tanzania teaching, A lot of people don't know Dr. Thomas was also banned from Jamaica after Rodney was banned. And Dr. Thomas had come back and was at the university, and Dr. Thomas urged him to come home. So he wanted to come home, and some of his close comrades were also urging him to come home. That brings him home.
Okay, it's 15 minutes now. We're going to take another commercial break, but let me just, it's unfolding right here in this interview. Walter Rodney was a black man. Dr. Clive Thomas is a black man. He's still alive and well. Good morning to you, sir. Who were all fighting against black regimes. That sends a strong message. I'll be back in just a while.
Giftland now caters for all your business furniture needs. Come, choose from our wide variety and enjoy remarkable savings. Desks, chairs, filing cabinets, storage cabinets, fireproof safes, folding tables and chairs for your complete office. And remember, for all your office equipment, it's Giftland. Giftland. Don't pay more. Don't settle for less.
It's a space you can unwind, relax, nestled at Lola Souvenirs, just 10 minutes from the city, comfort that lends to every taste, even for the businessman who relaxes while doing business.
Somewhere,
local and international cuisine that's sure to add flavor to your stay.
If I could fly like birds on high.
Coupled with our grill and poolside bar, the Grand Coastal Hotel is complete with our fitness center. Visit the Grand Coastal Hotel to relax for the cuisine. The Grand Coastal Hotel, creating memories.
Whether you need flashy magazines, stunning looking brochures for your customers, slick and professional business cards for new clients, or maybe posters to show off your new product, even packaging printout for your product boxes to give a clean look and feel, and slick labels for bottles and containers, and annual calendars for your businesses, plus that glossy UV finish. F&H Printing. Professionalism from start to finish.
So how come when I reach out my finger, it feels like more than distance between us? In this careless form of keeping, we're 10,000 miles apart. I bet careless form of wishing on this star.
Introducing Jet Boat Chartering Service. Between Parika and Waganon, the boat departs from Silver Beach to Leguan, around the Waganon, all the way to Supernum, and through the Essequibo River, all the way down to Barca and Baganara. We provide professional and comfortable service, like no other chartering service. Call for more information.
Do you know that powdered milk exposed to light loses its nutritional value? Are you confident of the hygienic conditions in which your milk was packaged? Is the measurement of your milk correct? Now, for the first time in Guyana, powdered milk is being packaged under the strictest of hygienic conditions in a UV-protected environment into metallized packaging, producing a product that is nutritional, healthy, and affordable. Introducing premium full cream milk powder, blending quality and taste.
Now open, Telco Solutions, Stellan Road, Reading Hoop, West Coast, Demerara. For all your cell phone and accessory needs, with reliable repairs and maintenance services, get connected with GTNT's DSL service, SIM card, C-Point, phone card, BlackBerry, and iPhone activations. Telco Solutions, we're making connectivity easier. Stellan Road, Reading Hoop, West Coast, Demerara. Telephone 264-0600.
Okay, 10 minutes now. On the left side of 8 o'clock, we're chatting with Dr. David Hinds and about Dr. Walter Rodney. Dr. Hinds, so this guy, Jamaica, then Cuba, then Tanzania, then Guyana.
Yes.
Home soil. He never left here after that when he came home. What year was that?
1974. Mm-hmm. He applied to head the history department at the University of Guyana.
He was refused?
He got the job.
Got the job.
And political intervention by the then PNC government led them to refuse him the job after
Burnham had a direct hand in that?
Yes, the government, at the highest level. At the highest level.
Burnham was everything.
Well, I mean, the prime minister in those days, Mr. Burnham was the prime minister. Mm-hmm. Nothing of that magnitude would happen without him.
Exactly.
Not being personally involved. There are a lot of controversies over which one of the ministers actually gave the order. Just as today, the university council is dominated by members of the ruling party, so
it was
in 1974. So when some of us take a very strong position against the practices of this present government, it is because some of the things...
You were burned by this before?
Yes, that we have fought against and we thought that we had eradicated paramountcy of the party over all the institutions, including the University of Guyana, was prominent then in 1974, and it's an eternal shame that in 2012, Freddie Kissoon is fired in the same manner at the University of Guyana.
So Rodney was fired?
Yes, he was given the job, and then they decided they no longer wanted him.
How long after you got the job?
He got the job and was preparing to come here to begin what we call the September term. And sometime between the end of the term before and September.
So he never taught a lesson at the university?
Well, he would later teach lessons at the university when the university student society would invite him to give guest lectures.
Guest lectures.
But he was never able to take up the appointment.
But why was he fired?
He was fired because the government said they had gotten word from Africa that he was a troublemaker. And so therefore, if you were a troublemaker in those days, you did not have the right to work, hence the right to raise your family and the right to life. It's a sorry period in Guyanese and Caribbean history that we have not fully confronted. And it was not just in Guyana, as we saw, it was in Jamaica, it was in Trinidad, it was all over. And it's a period in our history that we need to study more and to confront it. It's part of our post-colonial demons, as I call it.
So how did he earn? I mean, he was fired from the University of Guyana even before he got the job.
Yes.
How was he earning? I mean, he had a family by then?
Yes, he had three kids. Mm-hmm. A wife and three kids. He comes back to Guyana and decides that when he saw the people rallying in his defense, because ASCRIA, Brother UC's African Society for Cultural Relations with Independent Africa, mounted a series of public meetings to protest this firing of Rodney. And he brought together all the political forces in the opposition on that platform. It's the first time a UC Kwayan and Chedi Jagan would be on the same platform since the 1950s. And this was this massive public meetings of the size of that they were in 1953. And the government broke up the meetings and caused a lot of trouble. So Rodney began to make an impact among working people in this country before setting foot back here. Mm-hmm. And so he comes back and he says, I'm not going anywhere, I'm staying here. How did he make a living? He tried to teach at the high school. He applied to teach at Queen's College and they said no. And so what he would do is that he would travel out for a semester, go to England, go to Germany, go to the United States, teaches for a semester as a quote-unquote adjunct professor, mm-hmm. comes back in between, does his political work, comes back at the end of the semester. That is how he was forced to make a living.
And what year the WPA was formed?
WPA came together as a coalition of organizations in 1974. There's a little thing that I must say. People usually say Walter Rodney founded the WPA. The WPA had been meeting, that is, ASCRIA, IPRA, the Indian People's Revolutionary Associates, led by Moses Bhagwan, who you know very well. Mm-hmm. Moses Bhagwan was a rebel. He had been the head of the PPP's youth arm, the PYO. At that time, perhaps the second or third most powerful person in the PPP, fell out with the PPP. All right? And so here is Moses Bhagwan heading this Indian organization, Yusikwane heading the African organization, deciding the time is to come together and bring African and Indians together. Clive Thomas and Josh Ramsamy and others are at the University of Guyana with something called Ratoon. A university group. Then there was the Movement Against Oppression, which was a coalition of ordinary people here in the city and professors. They were part of the movement. And the Working People's Vanguard Party, led at the time by Brindley Benn, who was also a former chairman of the PPP. They came together in November of 1974 and formed the Working People's Alliance, not as a party, but as a pressure group. Rodney comes and joins.
Okay. So he was never the founder.
He was never the founder, but, you know, folklore. He was so overpowering, his presence was so overpowering, right? That folklore, the thing about Rodney is that the people accorded him the leadership of the movement. WPA was never a leader of the WPA. He was one of the leaders. He had one vote. He was not the maximum leader, but the people said he was the leader of the movement.
Mm-hmm. And I see there's a photograph. If you look on your screen there now, that was Dr. Rodney with Dr. Chetty Jagan.
Yes.
You can tell us something about that photo? You know what year it was?
That photo would have been taken sometime between 1969 and 74. While he's in Africa, he visits Guyana. He comes here once or twice per year. He would go see the PPP, Dr. Jagan. He would go see Yusikwane and Askria. He would go and he would talk to everyone in the political. One of the things about Rodney is that he did not intervene in a place if he did not find out what was going on. He did not come back to Guyana and say, I'm taking over. I know what's on. He came every year. He met with everyone. People in the PPP even said that he was supposed to have joined the PPP. Mm-hmm. All right? He respected Dr. Jagan. He knew that Dr. Jagan stood on the side of the working people. And Rodney was always concerned about racial unity. And for him, you could not have racial unity in Guyana without the PPP being part of it and without Dr. Jagan playing a central role.
So they struck up a good relationship?
Yes, a very good relationship. Very good relationship. The WPA and the PPP were allies in the struggle to bring back democracy in this country. Very close allies in the struggle. Sometimes if young people see the way in which the WPA and the PPP relate to each other or today would be surprised, but they were very, very close comrades.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's 2 minutes now to 8 o'clock. We're coming down to the final chapter because this is ending up to be a little lecture, educational lecture for all of us here. We're going to take another commercial break. When we come back, what happened on that fateful day?
Keep your vehicle well oiled and working its best with a quick service at the nearest Guy Loop Service Center, located at the Guy Oil Service Stations on Regent Street in Kitty, at Palmyra on the east coast of Burbies, and Diamond on the east bank. Get an oil and filter change or a general service of your electrical and mechanical systems with repairs Monday to Saturday, 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. at Guy Oil's Guy Loop Service Centers, Regent Street, Palmyra, Diamond on the East Bank, and Kitty, where you also get Castrol lubricants wholesale.
Guyanese are going to extraordinary lengths to protect themselves. You can save yourself a lot of money, anxiety, and worry by calling MMC Security Force, professionals who will design and outfit a security system for your home or business. MMC maintains high standards of selection and training in all areas, so you can always be assured of quality service. Our security team is staffed by trained and competent security professionals who maintain a 24-hour control center, monitoring all burglar alarm systems and dispatching the appropriate response in the event of an emergency. You've seen our security force power patrols, highly mobile, carefully selected, extensively trained, armed radio link vehicular units, which provide the most powerful private response in the country. We can equip your residence or business with a closed-circuit television system, armed or unarmed guards. And with TrackForce, our global positioning system, you'll always know where your belongings of value are. Contact MMC Security Force and we will put in place a security system that works for you, your residence, or business.
The
regal image of your office instills confidence in the quality of service you provide. Secure your office furnishings now to captivate your customers and clients. Wooden and metal, executive and semi-executive desks in various design sizes and finishes. Wooden and metal storage and filing cabinets, computer stations, and the widest range of executive and office chairs in different styles and colors for your comfort and that of your staff and customers. All available right now at Regal Stationery and Computer Center, 69 Seaford Street, Campbellville. Telephone 2254802 or 623-2704.
Hi, hon.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm great.
Isn't this the dress with the stamp?
Yes, it is.
Wow, it smells great. How do you do it?
I have my secret. Your secret is Mightyfoam powdered laundry detergent, the powerful active ingredient that breaks up tough stains while protecting your bright colors. Mightyfoam powdered laundry detergent, available in 900 and 500 gram sachets.
Habib, Habib, you remember me as your own child mother, Habib.
Who is your mom? And who is me?
This situation is very serious. Abby doesn't remember his name, where he lives, nothing at all. He'll have to undergo a very expensive operation.
Well, Doc, I got to find a good pawn shop and pawn these jewels. You know any good pawn shop?
Elegant Jewelry and Pawn Shop in Glover Street, between Camp Street and George Street.
Elegant Jewelry and Pawn Shop, number one in town.
Elegant Jewelry is number one pawn shop in Guyana.
Elegant Jewelry and Pawn Shop, that's the way to go.
Elegance is number one around the country.
Elegant Jewelry number one all the way.
Elegance number one, yeah. Cause I get the best deal, you know?
Elegant is the best pawn shop around town. The best. I encourage everyone to come here. The best pawn shop around town.
NT Computech is the place to shop. If you're looking for a personal computer or small, medium, or large business solutions, get desktops, laptops, servers, storage, and UPS. NT Computech carries the latest range of processors, motherboards, video cards, and hard drives. NT Computech provides services such as computer repairs, networking, CCTV surveillance, and APC infrastructure installation. NT Computech is an authorized reseller for Dell and APC products. We offer the best technical support and customer service in the business. NT Computech, your technology partner.
Good. Again, let me just remind you, we're chatting with Dr. David Hinds and from the WPA and all those many, many years that he spent close to Dr. Walter Rodney, who we were discussing this morning. So 1974, Doc, he came to Guyana, started this movement, not started, but joined in.
Yes.
With the various organizations, the Dr. Chetty Jagan, the Brindley Benz, and all of them. And then the WPA was formed. But I recall as a youngster, I was at Kitty Market Square. You can help me remember this year. But I had about 20,000 people, and people were on top of roofs. I have never seen, and I remember this picture vividly, on top of rooftops, because the street corners could not hold the people, and they were listening to Dr. Walter Rodney. That's the aura you were talking about that comes out
yes.
of this guy's body. Mm-hmm. He just simply attracts you. Mm-hmm. And when you look across, because at Border Mall, the average, if I recall, was the average just over 30,000 people were gathering together. This must have been driving some fear in Mr. Burnham.
Yes, yes, yes. It was. It's what we in the WPA dubbed the Civil Rebellion of 1979. The offices of the PNC, General Secretary, which was merged in the Ministry of National Development, was burned down. And the government proceeded to arrest a number of WPA leaders. Eventually, Dr. Rodney, Dr. Rupert Rupnarain, and Dr. Omowale were charged for arson. Others, such as Karen D'Souza, was also charged. Some of the other leaders.
But you were locked up too.
I was in prison at that. Well, not in 79, when Rodney died in 1980. I was in prison at the time. So a number of us were imprisoned.
So beaten. You were not on the street on that day?
On
On the fatal day?
On the fatal day, no. I was in my cell in Georgetown Prison and heard...
That's Camp Street.
And heard that blast and that night, didn't know what it was. And the next day, when they brought my breakfast, there was a note inside and said, Walter was murdered last night.
You cried?
I wept. The night they came into my cell, Kwame Apata was also in there at the time. They came into our cells all night, and they dug up the cell, removed the board. They kept us awake all night. They would come in, and they would ask me, have you heard anything from Dr. Rodney? What Dr. Rodney, what message he sent to you? And we didn't know what was happening, right? Then they would leave. I would try to get some sleep, and they would come back again, and they kept going all night. So I sensed something was wrong. I didn't know they had murdered Rodney. And the narrative that they had put out was that he was coming to the prison to free those of us who were in there.
To blow up the fence.
Right. So this whole thing about coming there and asking us what we know, if we had any contact with Dr. Rodney, was all part of this act.
So what time in the night you heard that explosion?
8 o'clock. I remember it very well. At 8 o'clock, because when you're in prison, the radio, you know, is your company. And there was a radio outside of my cell. They turned it off at 9 o'clock. So at 8 o'clock, you would listen. And I think there was a radio serial. Something would come over on Friday night. But, you know, you listen to the radio.
So it was a Friday.
So it was a Friday night. I knew it was 8 o'clock because the radio just said it was 8 o'clock. And then you heard this blast. And it's in Georgetown. You thought, well, okay, somebody shot something and so forth. Mm. And then by 9 o'clock, the security forces are in my cell. And that would go on until the next morning.
So when you read that note, I mean, who sent that note to you?
The membership of the party, they brought breakfast to me. And in those days, they would smuggle in day clean in my food. Mm-hmm. So that because you couldn't read day clean, which was the paper. So they would smuggle it in the food. Mm-hmm. And this note, as I was eating the morning,
You remember what you were eating?
I remember what I was eating. It was a sandwich. It was prepared by one of our comrades. She's still alive, Kathy Wills. She lives in Florida, and she cooked for us. And I mentioned that to say that there are people who made tremendous contribution to the struggle, who today are not given their due by this government, which is inheritors of that. And I remember eating that cheese sandwich the morning.
So while you're eating it, you're reading this note?
This note and the crunch of the note, and there's a note in the food, and I opened it in the piece of paper.
You didn't finish that sandwich?
I didn't finish that sandwich. I cried like a baby. I cried because I knew then that a chapter in Guyana's history had come to an end. I knew then that our task is going to be more difficult, and I dedicated myself, not knowing that all my other comrades were dedicating themselves, that we are never going to leave the struggle for freedom in Guyana, no matter who comes to power, that we see it as our responsibility to the struggles and the memory of Walter Rodney, that no matter what, we will continue to make our contributions. We hear every day the WPA is dead, and I want to say to people, WPA can never die. Here am I.
It lives inside of
Inside of all of us. It lives inside of Andaye, of Karen D'Souza. We are all doing different things, working with women, working with children, teaching at universities, working with people wherever they are. We do that because we feel that that is what Walter Rodney wanted us to do. You see? And we are determined that we are never going to use Walter Rodney to divide this country. Some people question our latest move to get into the Partnership for National Unity with the very party that was in power and responsible for the murder of Walter Rodney. And we say to them that Rodney would not want us to use him to hold back the movement towards uniting our people. That is what he was about. He said that a PNC that agreed to free and fair election is a PNC that he was prepared to work with. And a PNC that conceded free and fair election. Yes, we accuse them. We continue to say that they were responsible for the murder of Walter Rodney and that we want eventual closure and justice for Walter Rodney. But we think when we look at the struggles that people in this country, African and Indian and Amerindian people are going through, we cannot use Rodney to hold back that unity. The national unity that Rodney talked about and that we feel is necessary for this country must be a unity that brings together all of the forces, the PPP, the PNC, the WPA, the newer forces like the Alliance for Change. That is what Rodney was about. Rodney brought together all the racial and ethnic groups in this country. He brought together all the professional groups. It was not just racial unity, but it was class unity, the lawyers. He worked with church. He was tireless. In 1978, they put together something called the Citizens Committee and the Committee in Defense of Democracy, bringing together all the forces to stop the referendum that was being pushed at the time by the government to change the constitution into the one that we have now, which is like a millstone around our necks. Rodney fought to bring about that broad alliance. Let me say, Naim, one of the things about Walter Rodney, you mentioned it before break, here was a black man taking a stand against the black government. And I want to be very, very clear about this because it is very important. Here was a black man taking a stand against black governments in Africa, black governments in his homeland, because he felt that they had strayed away from the independence model, that strayed away from the working people who would propel them to power. And he felt that he needed to bring the working people together so that they can struggle for their own freedom, what he called self-activity, for self-emancipation. That if you organize people, not lead them, but organize them so that they can win their own freedom. Because as Rodney would say, if you win your freedom, you cherish it. If somebody wins that freedom for you, they can come tomorrow and say, give me back that freedom. And Walter Rodney came to Guyana and he did something remarkable. He was able to harness the rebellion of the Africans and the rebellion of the Indians against the rule, misrule of that day. And he fused them together in one movement.
But he did that in a short span of time.
5 years.
That the other political leaders were unable to do. I mean, for many, many years. Tell me something. Everybody seems to be asking this question. Yeah. Let me put it to you. Here was a guy was extremely bright, brilliant mind, great persona, great human being, another Mahatma Gandhi in his own right, coming here. I mean, do you think that Dr. Rodney perhaps acted a little idiotic to be holding a bomb in a car? I mean, any device that would go off? I mean, how this whole thing happened?
Well, he did not know it was a bomb that he was holding. The WPA was attempting to make walkie-talkies as a means of communicating. Some of the leaders lived in the countryside, some lived in town. The telephones were bogged, and so they were making these equipment in order to communicate with each other. And this double agent, Gregory Smith, who said he had left the army and had come over and convinced our leaders that he was genuine, and he volunteered to make this equipment and put a bomb in it and give to Dr. Rodney. He didn't know that he was holding
the bomb. But wasn't he too bright? Like, shouldn't you be delegating that to a technical person in the WPA?
That is the old paradigm. Mm-hmm. And as I usually tell people, so had he delegated it to me, then you're saying that my life is not worth as much as Rodney's life. That was not the Rodney way. Rodney was what the Rastafarians call a forwarder. Mm-hmm. When you were out there, he was there with you. He was a new kind of leader. Mm-hmm. He was not that kind of leader.
In front.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. He was not the one who sent the troops and stayed behind. He was not a coward. He was not a coward. If he always said, if I'm sending poor people out there to risk their lives, I'm going to be there with them. He said, I'm staying in Guyana because when I come here and I see the struggles of the people and I see the sacrifices that they're making, I cannot decide to leave because they didn't give me a job. There's so many people in Guyana who don't have jobs, who are struggling, and I want to be in their ranks. He was a quality leader, a different kind of leader. That's what makes people like myself hold on to the struggle to this day, because we know we come from a tradition that says we are all equal in this struggle. The top leader, the foot soldiers at the bottom, we're equal. And when we're going out there to face the goons, Rodney is there with us in the ranks. It gives me strength. Mm-hmm. It tells me that what I am doing here is very important. But more than that, that the person who is my leader cherishes his life in the same way that he cherishes mine, or vice versa.
But do you think Barnum gave that order directly to Gregory Smith? Look, put a bomb and kill that black man.
Let me put it this way. The kind of leadership that we had in the 1970s and the 1980s was the kind of leadership that something of that magnitude could not happen without the final word coming from the maximum leader. Now, there may be all kinds of variation about how that final word. Some of the leaders didn't say, go do it, but they would make pronouncements, and then others would feel, this is what the leader wants me to do. So there's that theory that there were people in the ranks of the state who felt that Mr. Burnham would have wanted this. There's that theory. So we have no way of knowing until there is a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. What we know is that Dr. Walter Rodney, shortly before he was murdered, left the country. And he had to leave illegally. Dr. Rodney. Uh-huh. He had to leave illegally because he was charged for arson and his passport was seized. He couldn't travel. He was invited by Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe had become independent. And Dr. Rodney, who had contributed to the freedom struggle in Africa, was invited by Robert Mugabe as his guest to go to the independence celebration.
So he eked out of Suriname.
He eked out through Suriname.
I wrote that in my O-level essay.
Exactly. Mm. The Rodney backtrack. Yes. The Rodney airport, as we call it.
And Burnham went to that.
Burnham went to the same.
And when he looked around, there was the
so goes the legend. Right? So goes the story. But here was Rodney in Africa. And he came back. He could have run away. He could have stayed. Right? But he came back because there was a trial. There were the rest of us here, some of us in prison. He came back here. And a week after then, he was murdered.
That bomb blew his body to parts. I mean, all over the car, he had his...
Yes, the bomb was meant to disfigure his face so that they would not know. The story would go that, oh, Rodney's not really dead. We don't know who it is, and so forth. But he did not hold the bomb up to his face. So his face was not disfigured. His lower body was, his bowels. Mm-hmm. And so although they put on the news that they couldn't recognize who he was recognizable.
So were you able to get out to attend his funeral?
No, no, they would never allow that. I was in there. But I tell you,
Naim, were you angry too? I mean,
lots, all kinds of emotions.
You felt you could have killed.
All kinds of emotions. I mean, for the first time, you're seeing a world crumbling, because what Rodney inspired us, you know, was hope that this thing is going to get better. This thing, Guyana, is going to be this place where we can live. In harmony, African and Indians, those large crowds that you are talking about, it's about Africa. We have not seen them since. We've not seen those kinds of crowds since. African and Indian people in the middle of Georgetown standing up and saying Guyana belongs to us. And here are Indian people saying to an African, we respect you, you can be our leader. The remarkable thing about Rodney is that he was able to fuse the ethnic groups in one place.
At a flick of a finger.
At a flick of a finger. A wonderful and great person. I think all Guyanese should make an effort to learn a little something about Dr. Rodney. And I hope this morning on your program that I've been able to offer some kind of understanding of who Walter Rodney was. Because if we understand Rodney, we understand our own selves. Here is a working class brother, coming from the bowels of the working class, rising to prominence, coming back to put his life at the service of the working class. I teach in the United States of America. As soon as my classes are finished, I come back home, because that's the Rodney way. This is where I belong. I'm forced to work someplace else, but this is where I belong. And we shall not rest. We want to say on this 32nd anniversary of Rodney's death that the elections of November 28 signaled once again that Rodney is alive. Because what we were able to do through what is now called the combined opposition, the votes of Indian Guyanese from Port Morant and Bath settlement on the quarantine, merging with the votes of African Guyanese from Demerara and the villages, coming together and giving us a parliament that can stand up and say to the executive, hold on, this country don't belong to you alone. It belongs to all of us.
As you sought to do when Barnum was
in government. Rodney is alive.
Look, Dr. Hinds, I know we can go on for another hour and a half program, but that's a whole nother discussion.
Yes.
This morning, it is such a pleasure. This is a distinct and personal pleasure of mine to have this opportunity to talk with you. I hope this would not be the last one.
I hope so too. And just to let the audience know, we are having a Walter Rodney lecture. We do an annual Walter Rodney lecture. It will be held on Friday, this Friday, at 5 o'clock at the Demerara Mutual Life Building at the corner of Avenue of the Republic and Rob Street at 5 p.m. And I will be giving the lecture under the theme, The Walter Rodney Legacy, The Task of Political and Racial Unity. That's on Friday at the Demerara Mutual Life Building, Avenue of the Republic, and Rob Street, hoping to see people come out there so we can have a wonderful discussion about the Rodney legacy and the movement forward for Guyana.
Thank you very much, Doc.
Thank you very much. Yes. And I first was introduced to you, your voice, as an enthusiast of cricket. And today I learned that you're an all-rounder.
Yes. Okay, we were chatting with Dr. David Hinds. We'll be back in just a while.
Get the best furniture at the NDS store at Crane on the west coast of Demerara and the new branch in Georgetown at Charlotte and Oranock Street. We use local wooden material and craftsmanship along with over 30 years' experience to give you the best quality and modern designs to suit your lifestyle and decor. Our higher purchase rates are the best. Get 90 days interest-free payments to start with free delivery. So remember, the NDS New Georgetown branch is now open at Charlotte and Oranock Street along with our Crane branch on the west coast of Demerara. Visit us soon.
Is fishing your profession? Then come to Gaffour's. In our fishing department, you'll find light, medium, and heavy-duty tarpaulins, polythene and nylon fishing nets, cast nets, fishing floats, one- and two-piece raincoats, long boots available in short tops with and without steel toes, Mustad fishing hooks, sizes from number 1 to number 20, fish coolers in 500 and 1500 pound capacity, sheet lead in thicknesses 1 millimeter to 3.15 millimeters, life jackets for adults and children, life rings, ice boxes and caulk in cotton. These are just a few of the many items we have available. So come to Gaffour's Fishing Department and see for yourself the range of products we've got in stock so you won't have to go anywhere else. For service, quality and price, it's Gaffour's, the name you can trust. Windows let the sun shine in and keep the rain at bay. Multi-Builders Incorporated, we offer modern building ideas for Guyana. Our product line includes awning windows, straight slide windows, new slide and folding windows, storefronts and showcases, made to your specifications from top quality non-corrosive aluminium profiles with electroplated coloring and glass in various thicknesses and colors. With installation and backup service from Multi-Builders Incorporated, our showroom is at 226 Camp Street and our factory at Lot 2 Eccles Industrial Estate, telephone 233-3105.
Hi, hon.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm great.
Isn't this the dress with the stamp?
Yes, it is.
Wow, it smells great. How do you do it?
I have my secret. Your secret is Mightyfoam powdered laundry detergent. A powerful active ingredient that breaks up tough stains while protecting your bright colors. Mightyfoam powdered laundry detergent. Available in 900 and 500 gram sachets.
The regal image of your office instills confidence in the quality of service you provide. Secure your office furnishings now to captivate your customers and clients. Wooden and metal, executive and semi-executive desks in various design sizes and finishes. Wooden and metal storage and filing cabinets, computer stations, and the widest range of executive and office chairs in different styles and colors for your comfort and that of your staff and customers. All available right now at Regal Stationery and Computer Center, 69 C43 Campbell Road, telephone 225-4802 or 623-2704.
Whether you want a lasting first impression at the front door or turn your bedroom into a relaxing retreat, Airwick offers a range of air freshener styles to suit your needs. With a wide range of products designed to fit into any home and blend with all decors, you're bound to find the right fragrance to personalize every room in your home. Airwick, it's good to be home. Available at VBAPS.
Do you know that powdered milk exposed to light loses its nutritional value? Are you confident of the hygienic conditions in which your milk was packaged? Is the measurement of your milk correct? Now, for the first time in Guyana, powdered milk is being packaged under the strictest of hygienic conditions in a UV-protected environment into metallized packaging, producing a product that is nutritional, healthy, and affordable. Introducing premium full cream milk powder, blending quality and taste.
Giftland now caters for all your business furniture needs. Come, choose from our wide variety and enjoy remarkable savings. Desks, chairs, filing cabinets, storage cabinets, fireproof safes, folding tables, and chairs for your complete office. And remember, for all your office equipment, it's Giftland. Giftland. Don't pay more. Don't settle for less.
Okay, this brings us to the end of the program, the Good Morning Guyana Show. Hope you enjoyed the stuff you heard from Dr. David Hinds, remembering Walter on this day. And he was my hero too, right? And Walter was settling in the eyes of Dr. Hinds when he started to describe how Dr. Rodney was blown apart. I could have seen Walter in his eyes. The legend in Rodney still lives on in the minds of many of those senior members. He was in the jail when he heard the explosion of his hero just down the road on Bend Street. He heard that explosion. He didn't know his hero was the victim of that explosion. Gotta go now, people. Good morning, Rihanna Hack. I understand she's celebrating her 17th birthday today. Good morning to you from your dad, Hazim, and your mom, and the rest of the family circle, your grandparent, your granddad. They'd all want to team up to wish you all the very best, okay? Happy birthday to you. Goodbye. Naim Chan here. Until tomorrow, on behalf of Levar and Jeremy.
हसी झील के साहिल पे हम